Hello and welcome to C++ Weekly. I've said that many times now. In this episode, I want to talk about the amazing performance of standard array. Now, my friend Lenny refers to standard array as the negative cost abstraction in C++, and I've probably mentioned that already at some point in some episode. That's not really the point here. I want to go over it again if I haven't already talked about it because I've been thinking a lot about array lately. So let's do that. We're just going to go ahead and include array, and we're going to look at some generated assembly code. If you're not familiar with this website I'm using, it's called Compiler Explorer, and you should be aware of it because it is an excellent tool for prototyping and investigating C++ code. But it doesn't only support C++, it also supports C, C Sharp, Kotlin, COBOL, CPPX, Java, Julia, Python, Prolog, Spice, I don't know. It supports all the programming languages. Maybe not all, but let's just say all. Let's say I've got a function. I'm going to call it sum. And this thing is going to take a vector of int. Very exciting. Vector and numeric, and I'm going to return the accumulate of data.begin, data.end, 0. There we go. I'm going to do that. And we're going to look at the generated code. Well, I mean, this is with like O3 enabled or something, and it's trying to do a partially unrolled vectorized add, I believe, of the elements of this vector because it doesn't know how many elements the vector has. There's just no way for this thing to know at compile time how many elements the vector is going to have. We could try taking it down a notch, and we could, there we go. This is a very straightforward loop now. It's just going to do a loop. Do, 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 add all of the values, return the result in EAX, move EDX to EAX. That is going to return the result from this function. Wow, that's really easy. Now I'm going to write another version of sum. And this one's going to take, I don't know, say 10 ints. And I'm going to do the literal exact same thing here. I'm going to use accumulate to sum up the values of the array. And now what I can see is even at O2, the compiler knows this thing has 10 elements in it. I'm just gonna do 10 adds. It's really straightforward. It knows at compile time that it's going to operate on 10 of these things. I'm going to do the marc equals native, which you should never ever do on Compiler Explorer, just to see how that changes things. Yeah, doesn't change things a whole lot, except we're getting these SIMD vectorized add things happening in the XMM registers. That's neat. That's spectacular. And if I put it in O3, it doesn't change it a whole lot. And we've got this vector one GCC is trying to be all fancy with its partial loop unrolling still. Let's go ahead and do clang trunc. And we get about the same kind of thing happening with the array with clang trunc and about the same kind of thing happening with the vector. All right, what level of optimization do we have to turn this down to? Let's see. All right, we do still have a loop happening with the array version. Now it knows that it's going to be doing exactly 10 loop iterations, so that's hard coded in here. That should be pretty good for the branch predictor and stuff, I would think. If we take it to O2, I'm expecting that we'll see that loop unrolling happening. Yes, we'll go back to GCC. At this point, I should probably apologize to my transcriber because I am just mentioning a bunch of random things on the screen all at once here. And yeah, at O1 in GCC, it does not do the loop unrolling with array, but it does hard code in the number of loop iterations that it needs to take. There, we're going to keep things on O2 here. That's the gist of it, right? The compiler knows at compile time how many elements it needs to do things with. All right, let's print these things using the range adapters for each. I need to include the algorithm header. And IO stream. Why am I using C out here? Well, hopefully we'll see in a moment. Oh, that's interesting. It actually does not unroll the loop for calls to C out, but it does unroll the summation that happens immediately after it. That's pretty neat. If we decrease the size of this array, again, we're sticking with compile time known sizes because that's required with array. I'm still not seeing GCC do it. I have seen GCC unroll calls to C out as well, because as you can see, it's actually a very simple call that it needs to make here. Let's go ahead and get rid of that. So the question that you might have is, does this hold true for span as well? The real advantage we get here is that the compiler knows the size of the thing at compile time. With span, we can similarly give it this size information at compile time. What is it gonna do? Let's see. Okay, good. It did the exact same thing. So maybe the title of this episode should be The Amazing Performance of Array and Span. They have very similar properties. They can be compile time known sized things, and they always operate on contiguous data. That's two of the most important things. Now, I'll just give you a hint here as to one other thing. Also, standard array has no constructors, and this is absolutely huge for how the data in the array is initialized when you have non-trivial types. But I'm not going to go into that in this episode, and I'm pretty sure I have gone into that in a previous episode. So thank you for watching this episode of C++ Weekly. The key being here, use compile time known sizes. Everything that you can push to compile time is another piece of information that your compiler can use to generate spectacular code for you. Catch you in the next episode.